Well, thank you very much, John, for that very warm introduction. Maybe if we turn that mic off, there won't be interference between the two, because I have a different one. And welcome everyone here. I'm glad you have such excellent weather for tonight's observations and tomorrow night as well. It's really great when people come together like this to enjoy astronomy, enjoy the skies, and I'm delighted to be here in this beautiful part of the country. I flew in today and it's just so green, you know? It's so wonderful. It's amazing. And I guess in a month, there'll be all the fall colors, but anyway, I'll have to come out a different time for that. So I'll be telling you tonight about this accelerating expansion of the universe. And as John said, I was a member of both teams that discovered this. I was the only person to have been a member at one time or another of both teams. And you might wonder how that happened, and you'd have to get me sufficiently drunk to tell you. But anyway, but never in my wildest dreams as a kid did I think I would be heavily involved in a discovery that so revolutionized our understanding of the universe and showed us actually how much we don't understand. It's just been a real dream come true. Now, I'll hopefully give something that everyone here can enjoy. I understand that the audience ranges from PhD physicists all the way down to young kids. So I'll have, I hope, something for everyone. But this discovery was recognized with the 2011 Nobel Prize in Physics to the team leaders. And the team leaders can be seen here. There's Saul Perlmutter, the head of the Supernova Cosmology Project, a colleague of mine at UC Berkeley. And then Brian Schmidt, the leader of the High Redshift Supernova Search Team. He's based in Australia. And then Adam Reese over here, now a professor at Johns Hopkins University. He was my postdoctoral scholar in the mid to late 1990s when we were doing the research that led to this discovery that the expansion of the universe is accelerating. I was his direct supervisor. And he showed me the results, and I was all, boy, this just really seems weird. Are you sure? You know, didn't they teach you how to make measurements of stars properly at Harvard? You know. Anyway, he checked and rechecked the results, and we were convinced they were right. And he was the lead author on the Schmidt team paper. And so all these years I've been kind of rooting for him that he get a share of the Nobel Prize if and when it gets given. Because there's this rule that the Nobel Prizes in the sciences can be given to at most three people. That's not true for the Peace Prize. It can be given to organizations like the Red Cross or the IPCC. But all the other Nobel Prizes are given to at most three people. And that's too bad because modern science occurs in teams now. Here's a picture of Schmidt's team, the High Redshift Supernova Search Team, right after the award of the Nobel Prize. Cosmologists are also interested in the fundamental building blocks of the universe. Those are the galaxies, gigantic collections of tens or hundreds of billions of stars gravitationally bound together into enormous structures, 100,000 light years across, for example. So if you were on a planet orbiting a star here and you sent a radio message at the speed of light to an alien friend over there saying, hey, let's go to the NEFAF thing, and hope it doesn't rain this year. And then, it would take 100,000 years for your message to get there and another 100,000 years for the reply to come back. And the reply would be, yeah, we'll bring your raincoat, for a total round-trip conversation of 200,000 years. Hardly a stimulating conversation, but that's not my fault. That's the way the universe is built. I'm just the messenger here. It's built out of these galaxies. And we live in one such galaxy, the Milky Way galaxy. This isn't a picture of it. If any of you out there have a picture of the Milky Way galaxy like this, please see me afterwards. I'd like to purchase usage rights from you. This is, of course, a view from outside. We're like a mouse inside the maze. It's hard to tell what the maze looks like from the inside, but from above, it's quite easy to see what the maze looks like. So, interestingly, we know what other galaxies look like in more detail than we know what our own galaxy looks like, yet we do know that ours is a spiral galaxy that probably looks a lot like this one, okay? A gigantic structure like this. And these galaxies are not at all rare. They're common. Here's one of my favorite photographs from the Hubble Space Telescope. This is part of what's called the Hubble Ultra Deep Field, where the telescope pointed at one part of the sky for about 10 days and gathered light. Now, this is a tiny but representative fraction of the sky. Imagine a grain of sand held at arm's length. Imagine how small that looks. That's about how small this patch of the sky is compared to the whole sky. Wow. Yet in this patch, there's something like a couple of thousand galaxies like our Milky Way. So you could count them. 1, 2, 3, 4. I could use up my hour counting galaxies, and that wouldn't be very interesting for you. But hey, it's a pretty cushy job. They pay us to sit around and count galaxies, okay? So for you youngsters here, it's not bad, okay? Anyway, several such photographs have been taken, so we can tell that this is representative because they, you know, broadly speaking, looks the same no matter which direction you look in. So we've calculated that within the realm of the Hubble telescope, there's something like 100 billion galaxies, each with tens or hundreds of billions of stars. And that's just in the parts of the universe that we can see. We now have good reasons to think that the universe extends far, far beyond just those parts that we can see. It's much, much bigger overall. And everywhere it's filled with these galaxies. So how do they form? How do they evolve with time? These are also among the central questions of cosmology. So you can see what an exciting, vibrant field it is. We're grasping at some of the most amazing questions that the human mind is capable of asking. And we're actually coming about ways to try to answer those questions. I feel very privileged to be working in this field. Well, before I move on, let me point out that among the general public, present company excluded, because many of you are astronomy enthusiasts and well-educated and stuff, but among the general public, there's considerable confusion between cosmology, the study of the structure and evolution of the universe as a whole, and cosmetology, the study of hairdos and facials. Now, you laugh, but they do sound similar, right, as do astronomy and astrology, right? But they're spelled differently, and if you write them down, I will leave this as an exercise, cosmetology is just cosmology with an extra ET in it, like extraterrestrial. No, write them down. I kid you not. I don't know the cosmic significance of that, but that's how cosmology and cosmetology differ. Now, you might think I'm just joking here, that surely no one has this confusion, okay? But let me give you evidence. Here's a copy of an ad that a colleague of mine placed in my mailbox a few months ago. Make cosmology your career. Training and supervision in hairstyling, blow drying, permanent waves, coloring and frosting, scalp treatments, body and skin care. By the way, you laugh, but these are important topics, okay? Style cuts, basic cuts. For further information and interviews, call that number. Now, classes started in March, so you missed the spring quarter. Maybe probably even the summer session.
Are those gravity waves?
Gravity waves, there you go. Oh, good one, I like that, yeah. So, from our perspective, things look something like this. Here we are, and they're all moving away, except, say, the Andromeda galaxy, which is gravitationally bound to ours in a little cluster, so it's moving towards us. But forget about those. All the ones outside our local cluster are moving away, but the more distant ones, right now, are moving away faster than the nearby ones. And this led to this idea of an expanding universe, an idea which, by the way, Hubble himself did not subscribe to for quite a long time. But later he accepted it. And we now know, actually, that it's an expansion of space itself. It's not that galaxies are moving through some pre-existing space like bullets. It's actually space itself that's expanding. That's truly remarkable. Let me pause here before I move on, because there's something a bit strange about this diagram as I've drawn it. What's strange about it? Yeah, we're all at the center. Why is that? Yeah, do all these other galaxies not like us? Is it something we said? Do we smell? Are all these other galaxies lactose intolerant? Get it? Milky Way galaxy, lactose intolerant. Yeah, I know. When I talk about cosmology to my introductory astronomy class at Cal, I say, what is it? Are we from Stanford or something, you know? Big rivalry. With due apologies to those of you who might be Stanford alumni, it's truly an outstanding school, just not quite as outstanding as Cal, okay? Anyway, no, we don't think we live in any special universe or special place in the universe. We think instead that no matter which galaxy we happen to be in, we would see all the others moving away with a speed that's proportional to the distance. This is what you get in a uniformly expanding universe. So here's a one-dimensional example. Okay, ping pong balls, those are the galaxies. By the way, the galaxies don't expand. They're gravitationally bound to such a degree that it resists the tendency of space to expand. You're not expanding either. You're bound by electromagnetic forces. You might think you've expanded after a big meal, but that's your fault. That's not the universe's fault. Okay, and of course, we're held to the ground by gravity. So the Earth is not expanding either. But the space between the galaxies, more precisely between clusters of galaxies, is expanding. Okay, so put yourself on this red one here, and you see that all the others are moving away. But so too is the case from any other perspective there. Okay, they're all moving away. And by the way, imagine either an infinite rubber band, the universe is either infinite, oops, there goes a galaxy that just fell out of the universe. How do you like that for a good trick? Or have a universe that wraps around itself. Again, there are no edges this way, but it's expanding out like that. So don't worry that this is a finite universe. Let's go back to the apple. If you measure the speed of the apple at many different points of its trajectory, and you notice that it's slowing down a lot, then you can calculate that it'll someday stop and come back down. If instead it hasn't been slowing down very much, then you can calculate that it'll expand forever. So by measuring the past history, you can predict the future. And so too with the universe. If we could measure the expansion rate as it was long ago and compare it with the currently known expansion rate, and do that at a bunch of times in the universe's history, we could figure out whether there's enough gravity to ever stop it or not to ever stop it. So that's the idea, okay? Well, we need to look back in time. How do we look back in time? We live at the present time. Anyone want to venture a guess? Telescopes, what about them? Looking into the past, but why? Speed of light, right. What's your name? Pardon?
Herb.
Herb says light takes time to travel from there to here. So in fact, light takes and travels at a speed of about a foot per nanosecond, a foot per billionth of a second. The finite speed of light gives you a movie of the history of the universe. And encoded in the light from those galaxies is information about how much the universe has stretched, expanded, during the time of flight of the light, of the photons. It's this redshift that I was talking about. Okay? So by looking at distant galaxies and measuring their distances and their redshifts, you can find deviations from this linear Hubble law, all right? I include a few graphs for those who like them, okay? But you don't need to understand the graphs if you don't want to. Just realize that you're looking far away, you're looking back in time, you can measure the expansion rate back in the past and compare it with the current expansion rate, okay? Suppose we determine that star John, lost my button there, is just like the left shoulder of Orion as seen by us, Betelgeuse. A brilliant, remarkable star, a red supergiant, an incredibly massive and luminous star, just an amazing star, actually. So let's, you know, and we know approximately the distance of Betelgeuse because it's a relatively nearby star and we have ways of determining distances of those. So if John is the same kind of star as Betelgeuse, but John looks faint, you can figure out how far away John is. And if you get the same answer for a bunch of stars, then you've got some confidence that you're applying the right technique. And Hubble used a type of star known as a Cepheid variable star. He measured them and he could recognize them and he found that they look really, really faint in things like the Andromeda Nebula, for example, and some other ones, which is what led to the realization that these so-called spiral nebulae were actually external galaxies. The technique is much the same as what you use to determine the distance of an oncoming car at night. You've calibrated how powerful, how luminous the headlights are of a nearby car of known distance. So let's say it's 6 feet away, and you go, whoa, that's a bright headlight, and you make a mental image of how powerful it is. Then you look at the headlights of other cars, and you almost intuitively, almost instinctively, can judge their approximate distance by how faint the headlights look. You're using the inverse square law of light, although you don't have to be, you know, mechanically doing that calculation. You become good at this just from experience. You know, if you're not good at doing this, then you shouldn't be driving at night, okay? Fortunately, there's a consistency check. The angular separation between the headlights decreases with increasing distance, and that gives you a consistency check. See, you'd better head over to these telescopes pretty soon, okay? Not immediately, I'm almost done, but pretty soon, within the next few tens of billions of years. Because beyond that time, these galaxies will have been whisked away by this runaway universe to distances so distant that the galaxies become too faint to see. All right? So that's what we thought when this cover story was written. But since then, it's been pointed out by theorists that given that we don't know what the dark energy is, it turns out there are some models, some theoretical hypotheses that are not outrageous, where the sign of the effect changes with time from one of repulsion to attraction. That's conceivable, okay? Many models lead to acceleration forever, but some lead to an eventual deceleration. And if there's enough of this stuff, and we're not quite sure exactly how much there is, then eventually, despite the current acceleration, eventually there'll be deceleration and possibly then even a halt and then a recollapse. So the big crunch. So the betting person would say the odds are for continued expansion, at least for a really long time. But if you talk about eternity, then we're not so sure. By the way, Woody Allen said eternity is an awfully long time, especially near the end, right? So we're not sure how the universe will actually end, all right? Well, Robert Frost may not have known about dark energy and acceleration. In fact, he surely didn't, okay? But he was at least sufficiently well educated to know that there were these two possibilities for the universe. The big crunch ending compressed and hot, sort of like fire, and eternal expansion ending dark and dilute and cold, like ice. Because he had this poem, right? Fire and ice. Some say the world will end in fire. Some say in ice. From what I've tasted of desire, I hold with those who favor fire. But if it had to perish twice, I think I know enough of hate to say that for destruction, ice is also great and would suffice. So you see, Frost would prefer this type of universe. But if the universe and if he had to perish twice, then eternal expansion and an ending in ice would be okay with him. And that's perhaps appropriate, given his name, Robert Frost. Thank you very much for your attention.